So, welcome to the Edge Rowing Podcast. Today, I'm pretty excited to say, pretty excited sounds like I'm not excited. Fully. I am excited. I'm
100%.
Moderately excited to say that we've got Alan Sinclair here. So, Alan's been working with us for, close to a year now at Edge Rowing. He's also the head coach of St. Andrews University Boat Club. He's a former Olympian, recent husband as well, and a father as well. So loads of stuff about Alan's journey that I want to get into, and so many unique points where I think he really brings value as a coach. But I just thought it'd be really cool to go deep dive into your journey and uncover sort of your approach to how you went about achieving what you did and doing it in a way that the people listening or watching or whatever can take home some advice. Because I guess... Yeah, like, I always think it's so much more interesting the people that didn't just have, like, a big, huge erg score and, like, have quite a quick progression into the team. I think it's, there's so much more value in people that, you know, maybe genetically or whatever, for whatever reason, it took them a bit longer to get in. They have to go and look at so many other areas that are more relatable to somebody that's listening. But yeah, anyways, I'll stop friggin' going off on a I'm going off on a tangent already. But yeah, Alan.
Nice to be here. You're like starting off your podcast interviewing career well.
Yeah, Alan has actually given me a bit of shit earlier because he was expecting me to wine and dine him, take him out to lunch. I did offer him a coffee.
Doesn't drink coffee.
He doesn't drink coffee. I should have
a glass of water.
Maybe a protein shake or something like that.
Cool.
Just thought we could get into it. And sure. Obviously, I know your story and everything. But obviously, I'm sure people here don't. So would be good to go back to kind of when you first started, Alan, and like what did the start of your kind of rowing journey look like, if you can go into that a little bit.
I started rowing as a result of my dad's co-founding Inverness Rowing Club. So
which, for those that don't, Inverness is kind of like really far north up in Scotland, so you get some pretty brutal winters
there. To the internationals out there, Loch Ness.
By Loch Ness.
So we rowed with Loch Ness Monster. And they were really good and really, really instrumental in my development.
Yeah, of course.
My dad's he co-founded the club, and it was a tiny club, all masters or veteran rowers, whatever you want to call them. And when I was pretty small, and I was quite small for quite a long time, at weekends where I was at loose end, my dad would say, come on, let's get down to the rowing club and you can go out in a Cox 4. And so I did that and it was okay. I didn't really enjoy it. It was
going out coxing it?
Coxing. So I was small. Well, I was skinny. And mm-hmm. I hadn't stretched out.
Was skinny?
Well, I am now again skinny. For a period of time, a long period of time, I was skinny. And now I'm again skinny.
Nah, I'm only kidding.
Anyway, after I'd done a period of just playing about in those boats, my dad put me out in an aqua jog, which I don't know if people still have that, but it's like a tub single.
I was picturing like you in like one of those hydrotherapy.
No.
You can run underneath the water.
I thought that the very first time my dad mentioned the word aqua jog. I was like, is this some crazy like rowing treadmill that I'm going to be in the water in somehow as well? Turns out it's just a really, really basic tub single. I thought it was more fun. It was a lot less stable than a competent four and then me coxing it. But
I remember when I first started, I was like, I went from one of those into a narrow single and I was like,
what the hell?
The tub singles are so much quicker. I can just lay down so much more power.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm going to be the first guy to race all over the country in one of these.
Yeah.
Pros and cons.
So yeah, I... went out in a few singles, I didn't get the bug really. I just I liked the fact that I was doing something that there wasn't many people doing at my age, certainly in the area. So I was
a very small
pond, like a minuscule pond, and I was the only fish. So that kind of appealed to me. And my dad would say that there's one time, so the older rowers watching this or listening to this will know of a guy called Peter Haining, mm-hmm. Lightweight sculler back in the day. And he won the world champs in, I think it was 93, 94, 95, lightweight single. But anyway, he came up to Inverness to do a kind of coaching thing. And I'd just, like, that month started rowing. I'd been out in a single. My dad still remembers, I don't remember this, but apparently when Peter asked me, what is it you like about rowing, what's the fun thing? And I replied with, I like it when I go fast. And the room like erupted and thought it was amazing that someone, and maybe that was the first hint of maybe something, but obviously that was quickly dampened when they saw that I was not physically capable. But my dad still loves talking about that and how that's where he thinks I started having some kind of competition in my head, but I didn't. It wasn't until I went to university, really, that I caught the bug, I would say. I did race as a junior. I was lucky enough to go to a couple of training camps with George Watson's College. Made a few friends from that I'm still in touch with, and they're really nice guys, and gave me a sense of, oh, this is actually kind of, well, it's a lot more fun when you're doing it with people your own age with kind of similar abilities. But yeah, I didn't fully get the bug until university in Aberdeen. I actually went there partly as a result of meeting Charlie, who you've had in the podcast already.
Yeah.
Charlie Simpson, he was at Inverness for a training camp with his eight that he was coaching at the time from Aberdeen, all of whom included Colin Williamson, who's now Edinburgh.
Sure, I'm actually going to have Colin on as well.
Yeah, you got to get Colin on. And he, I was actually asked to jump in the crew because one of the guys, I think, had an exam or had something on. So I jumped in the crew. And this is when Charlie, like, was fairly early on to having a heart rate monitor and doing lots of testing. And people didn't generally have heart monitors, but he had like a set of eight that stored them in the strap. And so I went out in this boat, I'm like, the strap on, I'm thinking, this is so high tech, so scientific. And Charlie said to my dad after that session, he'd be a good lightweight, and he's definitely got some character, I think is what the word he used. Because apparently it was an UT2 session, it was just mileage, it was like 20k or something. And I had sat with my heart rate at like 185 the entire day, the entire time, just steady.
Just low intensity.
Yeah. I was just pulling my nut off to try and stay in time. So, because of that group that was Aberdeen at the time, I thought that's awesome. I was thinking of going there for university anyway, and that sold it for me. So went there, started engineering. I say started because I never finished it. I actually didn't really enjoy it, but that's on me. Did enjoy rowing. Maybe again, that's on me, and I just got fully immersed and loved the shared goal that the team has, even though it was fairly modest in the grand scheme of things. Loved just that camaraderie that you have from getting up at 5 a.m. to do an ergo in the dark and rowing in complete darkness and freezing cold, and just like nothing that is nice but somehow was so satisfying.
Thing I wonder, like, because I was always quite like internally motivated, like, and I like learned to go in a single, and my first year I was pretty much always in a single. And for me the goals were always quite internally motivated. It was never really about the team side. That was good, but I spent very little time in teams. Was there anything that you think, like, if you hadn't been in a team environment, do you think you would have gotten the same the same bug?
No, I don't think so. I think I've kind of gone full circle. So I started off doing nothing but a single as a junior.
Yeah.
And I did it. I liked rowing better. I liked feeling like I was moving the boat with less effort. But it took me age. I didn't figure out that I needed to pull hard to go fast until I still need to figure that out. But it was when I felt like I was pulling for somebody else that I then did the thing I needed to do to make myself go fast. And then once I learned that skill, once I learned how to be competitive, then I had a greater appreciation for, I can do this on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I can enjoy doing it on my own. So it took me that kind of, I needed to take a step off the road that you did to then figure out what you had from the start, by the sounds of things.
That
internal motivation, mm-hmm. I didn't really have that. I liked going out in the water, I liked going to competitions, I hated racing, I liked the process.
I didn't like the racing at all at the start.
Yeah.
I learned to like racing.
Yeah.
It sounds so lame in rowing. It's like there's all these things you like learn to enjoy them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I wonder, okay, so like as you're like, I guess kind of jumping ahead a little bit, like when you are getting competitive and doing trials and erg tests, it's obviously very much about you. Like, were you quite internally focused then, or were you still kind of like, you wanna, like, what was motivating you as you started to push your kind of own performance?
I think it was mostly curiosity. It wasn't that I definitely didn't, there wasn't a race that had happened or an event I'd won and thought, if I go and do this event that's this much higher up in terms of standard, that it would be like exponentially more enjoyable. Mm. It wasn't like that's what I need to have. It was more, I really wanted to find out where my limits lay, like where was going to be the point that I couldn't get more out of myself.
Yeah. Well, why did you? Why do you feel like you wanted to, like, find that out?
I don't know. I guess probably originally it was probably as a result of not enjoying my degree and running away from the fact that I needed to, accept that it wasn't for me, and rowing was probably an outlet for me to feel like I could be good at something and enjoy it at the same time. Like, I wasn't good by any stretch of the imagination when I was at university. I was okay, but I certainly felt like I was getting better at it. And I was, the effort I was putting in was giving me something back. Whereas with my degree, with my studies, I felt like I was trying, but I wasn't enjoying it and or wasn't getting better as a result. It wasn't like it was opening up more options for me, whereas rowing was.
Yeah.
So I kind of therapy. Give myself some therapy right now. That's a good question, though.
I really find it interesting, like just getting to the root of like where this stuff comes from. So
I think it was probably that, and maybe running away. Maybe it was just me running away from the reality of I don't want to have a real job, and this is an opportunity for me not to do that, and then I realized how much more fun that could be.
What kind of job at the time would you have, like, were there any other jobs, like?
No, there wasn't. Like,
was it just quite fancied sports?
I think I just...
Or was rowing?
I don't know. I guess I went back to me when I was like 13, 14, 15. I was like a skater kid. I had inline skates, baggy jeans, and I loved like anything to do with like aggressive sports.
Did you do roller derby?
No, I did not.
Wait, you said inline skates, is that the roller blades?
That's the inline, so the blades, yeah. Blades.
When we started training at Clydesdale, we would do the circuits in the gym, and then the court was split in half, and the other side there was roller derby.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it looked fun.
Yeah, I've never done it.
Extreme.
Yeah. Extreme.
But yeah, maybe it's something you can pick up.
I was like big into snowboarding and... I think I just liked the idea of being quite free and just being wild, and rowing initially didn't seem like that was going to be the thing to get me there. But I also acknowledged that I'd never be good at. I think I had a default awareness that I wasn't inherently good at any sport. It wasn't like, okay. Oh, I just took to anything. Like, I was okay at athletic stuff. I was okay at cross country, and I played in goals at school for football, and I would be an okay athlete, but I was far from anything someone would go, oh, we can pick him up and put him into this program and he will like go up with this. It was, and so that was my kind of process. And when I, when it comes to like my job side of things, I just didn't know what I wanted to do. And maybe I could have or should have taken a year out to find that stuff out, but it wasn't like,
it's the classic thing at that age, you just get told like you need to make your decision now, or if you get it and you get it wrong, you're gonna die.
Yeah, yeah, it was very much, you're good at technical drawing, you're okay at maths, you're good at this, you're definitely not good at English, so you should go towards engineering or something like that. And so yeah, I think it was very much and that's like, maybe that's the root of why I don't necessarily like the kind of world-class start, I don't like it. I see flaws in it, because
it works, but the flaw
I see is that if you tell somebody they should be good at it, anything that falls below good is a failure.
Yeah, and likewise, the amount of people you're saying in like, yeah, you're saying we'll never be good at it because you're not this high.
Yeah. Yeah.
Whatever. It's such, yeah, you think about the national governing bodies, like what they should be doing. It's about encouraging everybody to do sport, not being exclusive. But sorry, that's me. I'll get into a rant.
No, it was. This is interesting. And I think it's been kind of shaping for my career as a result, because I clearly went to something I wasn't necessarily going to be that good at.
Mm-hmm.
I enjoyed, like, accepted, and I guess because I knew where my place was, I was content knowing that no one's told me I should be good at this, so anything that I get from this is a bonus. I guess that's your success. Like, there's only way to go is up, and everything I get from this is going to be a good thing. So like, this, there's always going to be a more positive mindset to have, and I know that there's like limits to that, but and I have been very fortunate, although I'm not saying that anybody can get to Olympic level. Like, rowing is one of the sports you can commit a lot to and get a lot more back than other sports might give you.
That's why I friggin' hated golf. Because it was the opposite of input. Rowing's so input, output.
Yeah.
And golf is like input, fish. it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah. That's true.
But yeah, that's interesting as well, talking about, I was just thinking about that when you said that, about as soon as someone says you're going to be good at something, and then any less than that is a failure. It also is very like outcome focused as well, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's like, then you're ever thinking about is being good at it. All you're ever thinking about is the result, and not necessarily being in the moment and focusing on the process, which is what we talk about all the time.
Yeah.
Okay. What were you doing? Like, what do you think you were doing at that time? I'm sure you had some awareness that as you started to develop, like, what do you think you were doing in Aberdeen, and then later on as you moved on to other clubs, that was like allowing you to step on and show progress?
I think the main thing, I'm lucky in hindsight, and I enjoyed looking back at my career and seeing areas I could have done better and areas I could have chilled out on. But the most satisfying and enjoyable and like performance success periods of my rowing career, in terms of like the linear progression, kind of just always getting better, was the times where I was super curious, and I found ways to make training as enjoyable as it could be, and I did my best not to get bogged down by smaller things. And obviously there's days where you do, like
that's
always the case when you get to at some point in your training cycle or whatever.
So just to hear you say, the curiosity, was that like, okay, you were saying before, like, curiosity to see how good you could get. Was there any, like, more specific stuff about the curiosity? Like, oh, what would happen in this stroke if I did it like this? Or what would happen if I pulled like that?
Yeah, I was a geek. I was a rowing geek. Like, okay. I love a rowing video as much as the next guy.
Rowing video.
It's,
did they have YouTube back in those days?
Yeah, well, actually, VHS. I've got a ton of VHS. I record in rowing videos like a normal person did back in the day. When Roy came on the TV and the BBC, he put a tape in.
Oh, would you?
And he recorded it.
Oh, that is old school.
Yeah, man. And then I started, there's a few tapes that got worn out from watching. But,
that's funny.
It's I should look them out.
Which videos were you watching? Races, like World Champs?
Just World Champs, yeah. I didn't make training videos. Like, you couldn't get that stuff.
It's so cool how, like, social media and stuff, like, you can share.
Yeah.
You take it for granted, all this stuff that's at your fingertips. All these great podcasts out here that have great guests and great hosts. You hear that? Oh dear. Okay, anyways. The curiosity about
I was a geek. Well, it was
I had Taylor on as well. So Taylor's one of our other coaches. Okay. And that's one thing he was talking about. So I didn't know you did that. That's something I did as well. Obviously I didn't get near the level you guys did, but you know, I wonder how much truth there is in just like watching footage and like, what were you doing when you were watching the footage? I'm curious. Like, because when I did it, I was like watching them, imagining myself doing it. I'm looking at the good crews. What was the crew in first versus sixth? What was the difference in their technique? Like, what were you looking at? Were you just like, oh, rowing?
It was kind of just early on, obviously, just in all of them. I'm thinking probably something really, really objective. In a visual sense of, they've got big legs, therefore the only way I can go fast is if I get big legs. I never did, for the record. Why I didn't win top level. I would look at stuff. I'd look at like the equipment they're using, and out of curiosity, I just think, why is that person using that thing that's different to that person? I mean, but there must be a reason for that. Why is that the case? I never got the answer, but I always tried to go through that dialogue in my head of like, why is that crew racing higher than that crew? Is it because they're fitter, or is it because they've got gearing differently? And how can you gear differently to rate higher? And just all those kind of things that I never really had. I probably should have done more reading to understand and kind of answer this question for myself. But I kind of went along this dialogue internally of there's the kind of overarching narrative was that everyone can do something very different and achieve the same outcome.
Yeah.
So like there's somebody who can rate 40 down the track and somebody rate 32, and they might get the exact same speed. They might apply the same amount of watts over the full track. They might apply completely different watts, but get the same speed. And ultimately, I was curious about what I wanted mine to be, what would be my ideal race, and what maybe works for me to get into crews where I can increase my performance further, and like how could I make other people better?
I remember you saying that's one thing as well. You said before that I really liked, what was it? How can your approach to it was just, how can I get the most out of the people around you when you go into a crew boat?
Yeah.
Which I just, I get, sorry, that's a slight tangent, but I really like that take. But, so you're watching the footage then. Anything else specifically about your kind of curiosity that, is that?
No, right? I think, well, for years it was just like me wanting to, see where I could go. I guess because I'd exceeded what I'd expectations of my early coaches.
What did your early coach, did any of them be like, you're going to be good?
So like, Ali Patterson, if you're watching, hi.
Hi, Ali. Like and subscribe, Ali.
She coached me at Aberdeen. She was my first coach. I had Ian Hunter, rest in peace. He was from Inverness Rowing Club, and he was an incredible coach. But Ali took me at Aberdeen, and myself and Colin were both in that group at the same time. And I remember having a conversation with her and asking, because at the time Colin was like the star, the star rower in our squad. And I think he'd done maybe a 6.08 or something in his 2K, which was good back in my day.
Yeah, yeah.
That was good. But at the time I was doing like a 6.40 or something. So she's totally within her right to say what she said. And
6.40, wow.
I think it was around about that.
What age?
30 something, maybe 19.
So, right. Okay, so for those listening, 6.40 at age 19, and then your PB, what did you pull? What was your PB?
5.50.
And what age were you then?
How old am I now? 34?
I don't know. What are you looking
for? I'm too old. It's too many numbers now.
So yeah, that's crazy progress, because I think, you know, and then when you were like around 5.51, 52 or something like that, probably around 28, 30, is that right?
Yeah. I was 51 at age 30, yeah.
Yeah. So that's pretty crazy progress, if you ask me, for someone that had already, you weren't even as a novice, if you came in as a novice and pulled 6.40 at 19, you'd maybe be looking at, okay, you might be able to crack 6.15 or something like that if you get well trained. So that's insane.
Yeah. But yeah, Ali, she said, I asked her, do you think Colin, I think it was immediately after the boat race, I said, do you think Colin could ever get into the boat race crew? Like, would he be good enough if he went to Oxford or Cambridge into their blue boat? And she could just paused for a moment and said, thought about it and said, I think if he really worked at it, obviously if academics assumed, if he really worked with it, he could make it into the Goldie or Isis boat, so the second crew. And in my mind, I was like, wow, that is the standard you have to hit to get into that crew. And obviously Colin exceeded that standard as well.
Yeah.
He was a great athlete in his own right. But little me at that time, I was like, well, she thinks Colin can't get to that. There's nowhere, like, way back from that. So when I got to the point where I could...
So just in that, like, I'm quite a spiteful person. I like to prove people wrong. As much as I'm sure, like, it sounds like your Ali was, like, really good coach. But even when someone says it with, like, good intentions, was there any, like, element of wanting to prove someone wrong?
Not at that time, because it wasn't a question about me.
Right.
It was an assumed thing.
Okay.
There's been people, there were people over my my career after that, sounds like similar things to you had. I had spiteful moments of, I'm going to prove them wrong. I on occasion did, which was satisfying, but I definitely wouldn't say it was the root of my motivation.
I was just kind of curious.
It definitely wasn't something that I was like, I wasn't fueled by rage or that. There was the odd occasion when someone would doubt me and I'd be like triggered by it.
Okay.
But it'd be a fairly short term.
You don't seem like a spiteful person.
No, thanks.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good thing, I guess.
I'm a good actor.
Yeah.
She kind of gave me that, this is where I'm at in terms of her assumptions, or like what the impression I get she has of her assumptions of me. And when I kind of started to kind of surpass that, and people started to say, oh, like Alan's like still at it, or he's gone much further than we thought, or he made big jumps, like that to me felt special. And so I guess I wondered when that point would end. And I was curious to see what it felt like when I'd hit the point where I wouldn't get any more of that. So just kept doing it. And because I kept on raising the ceiling, I just stuck at it. And I enjoyed that process of just finding out what if I could be better, if I could find out, if I could learn a way to make a book better.
What did you find hard about making that progression? Like, what were some of the, if you can remember at all, a long time ago, but any of the, any big steps or hurdles you had to overcome?
Yeah, like the training volume was a big thing. Like I remember going to Leander thinking, wow, this is a big shift in just feeling just fatigued all the time.
Where did you go? So, okay, yeah, kind of like, I guess, kind of fast forwarding a little bit then. What was the jump like? So you went from Aberdeen, you got invited or down to Leander?
No.
I did,
yeah. I asked.
Scrubbing the toilets.
If I can join. And at the time, they had prerequisites. I'm not sure if the prerequisite height and age, but they definitely asked those things. Definitely had a prerequisite, ergo score of 620, which I hadn't done.
Really? What is it now? I think it's a lot more than that.
Oh, yeah, it's way faster than that now.
Probably 6,000.
But I hadn't done that. I'll just put it down like I have because I'm going to go. I'll get found out. If I get found out, that's going to be the end, but at least I know I've had a crack at it.
Yeah.
But I think my 2K before going was maybe a 622, 623, maybe.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah. It's not if there's like a rule. I was still cheating.
But I was more meaning like if you showed up and you were doing like 15 splits behind everybody at UT2.
No.
And you're
I was pulling crazy hard to, but I because of the purely because just I never trained as much as I did. So I went from whatever it was 622, 23 to 616 about must have been like 6 weeks later. So
648 at 19, 622 at like what, 22, 23?
20, yeah, 21, 22.
Okay. Any sniffer GB stuff, under 23 stuff, trials, at that? Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Never under 23 level.
So again, like for someone that normally gets into the Olympics, you know, usual path is you do some junior, you do some under 23s. You know, you're on the radar with like selectors and stuff. So again, I just think it's quite interesting that you flew under the radar for a long time until you even at Leander, you know, it still took a bit of time to make impressions.
Yeah, I think that
So for those, again, I don't know if we come, for those who don't know, Leander is like kind of the big amateur club in the UK, which is very heavily funded. You don't get paid when you're there. I shouldn't have put the amateur in quotes. But the paid coaches, like reduced food and stuff like that. Well, reduced price of food, like really good equipment. It's quite a good club. They like to take all the people with all the potential right before they get into the GB team and claim them as their own. I'm just kidding. Because I rode there and it was really good setup. But anyway, so you moved down from Aberdeen, which is like total not on the radar for top GB clubs. To go to Leander. Just giving context for everybody.
That's okay, that's fine.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was very much... I went down there because I wanted to win Henley.
Right.
I raced at Henley in 2005? Five was the first year. I did it in the Brit. I got to the semi-final with Aberdeen. And then... I think it was that. But... Yeah, no, six as well. But then it was seven, I did a quad with like Drew Henry and Andy Crosland and Peter Shannon. It was kind of a last minute quad thing and we did get through a round, but it kind of confirmed to me that I really wanted to go to Leander that next year. And I joined because I just loved the regatta because of what it felt like to be part of such a big thing. Like I'm not like someone who likes, it wasn't the traditional side of it and the kind of posh stuff that I was excited by. It was more just the spectacle, like being in such a kind of tense racing environment, like one-on-one in effectively a cage because you've got these booms all the way down the course and you're fighting with this other crew until you get to the finish line.
Every rower's bucket list, I think.
Yeah, it has to be.
Better than Head of the Charles, by far.
Yeah, I think so.
I went to Head of the Charles. I didn't compete in it, and then...
It's totally different. Like, as a head race, Head of the Charles is incredible, but it's just, like, you can't...
It's so much better.
Yeah, it's... I think that was what I wanted to be part of, was just to be able to say that I'd... done something significant in an event which I cared so much about.
And why did you want to be able to? Sorry, why did you want to be able to say that?
Just for myself, like I felt like it was something that was special that no one would have. I couldn't name any Scottish person apart from the Aberdeen crew that won Henley at that stage in my career. I didn't know any Scottish people that had won Henley, and so I was like, that'd be cool to be the first person that I know of that is Scottish and come from, certainly from Inverness. No one I know of. So no one's won Henley from Inverness Rowing Club yet, until me. And then I'm looking forward to what the next person that does. But just feeling like I could stand out obviously meant something to me at the time. Like since then, like a different perspective, outlook on life, and kind of seems a bit shallow now looking back on it, but that was definitely what fueled me, just feeling like I could be define myself by doing something that was a bit different and special and exciting and ultimately enjoying that process of crossing the line in front. But it was Leander to me made the most sense because it's in Henley, it's the best club in the country.
So what was the kind of jump then from Aberdeen? You mentioned an increase in volume. What was the kind of increase in weekly mileage?
Best part of 100k, but
increased to 100k.
Probably about. Well, I went from like probably one or two sessions for 3 or 4 days a week to two sessions a day, pretty much every day. I know the program's definitely developed since then, but it was the consistency of every day doing a couple, and you got the Sunday off, and each week there would be some form of not testing, but like I remember the first year doing a lot of side by side stuff at Dorney, and then there was a lot of through the winter we do 3K pieces like down the length of the river in singles, and I just felt like you're just always getting battered, and felt awesome. I loved it.
Was there any element of like overwhelm or fear or like
I got excited by the fact that I was expecting to get cut.
Oh, okay.
I was expecting myself to not last very long, so I was constantly like just gonna make sure I beat a couple people.
You didn't have to pace it.
No,
Watch out for Henley.
I was thinking just gotta stay in here. Gotta make sure I'm not gonna get cut, and and whatever that means. Like if I end up just absolutely tanking by the time it comes to the summer, it doesn't matter because at least I've stayed in the club and I've proven to myself that I'm worthy of being there. Because in my mind at the time was like, this club has produced the best rower in the world ever. Like Sir Steve Redgrave, Sir Matthew Prince, and that was their home club. So in my mind, I was like, if I can prove to myself and the club that I deserve to be there, that's special in itself. That's kind of how my mentality was that for the first year.
So that's quite a good way, actually. I was just thinking there when you said that. That's quite a good way to set like sort of like shorter term goals and shorter term like affirmations. Or kind of like what got you to the Olympics was sort of having these like little, things. It wasn't like when you got into Leander. It wasn't like, I need to be the top ranked guy going and winning trials. I just need to be there so that I can show, like, that's something in itself. So, yeah, maybe something that could be a bit of a take home for people is like, how can you find these like little wins and like little ego boosts, I guess.
Yeah, I think I got better at that at stages of my career and being a bit more aware of myself and more about where I was and appreciating that it was special in that moment. Mm-hmm. There's definitely times I could have done a better job of that and I got too immersed or too fixated on the next thing. I know my family used to always say it was frustrating to support me because if I did really well in an event, they knew if I didn't do well, I would be disappointed or kind of frustrated. And if I did well, they would get frustrated because I wasn't elated. And they would say, oh, well done, you got a silver medal or World Cup, whatever it was. And I'd be like, oh, yeah, we could have done this better, though. I was always thinking of what I could do. And there's obviously positives and negatives to come from that. Like, I think there is a balance to have between celebrating a success for what it is and what you've achieved, but then having the reflective ability to go, well, what could I have done better? Yeah. But not blend them too much together, because I think if you get too complacent, having congratulated yourself, pat yourself on the back too much, then maybe you go to the next thing that you're going to feel like, oh, I've earned this right to win again, so therefore I don't have to work as hard.
That was something I learned, I think, after my first good trials performance. I took my foot off the gas a little bit and was like, I've got it. I've done, now I'm at this level, and now I'm going to stay at this level. And I think it's easy to train after a bad result. It's easy to train hard after a bad result, but it's hard to train hard after a good result. And that was one thing I learned, is like, even when I had a good result or you hit a PB, you of course celebrate, but you very quickly, and maybe that's why you kind of have all this like post-Olympic depression and stuff like that, because to get to this like level, you do always have to be moving forward.
I think you're right. I think
it's so hard to balance.
I still see it in, like, when I talk to my friends in the team now, like, there's still that, I feel like I want to inject them with the stuff, okay, the reality of what I now can see would have been more healthy to have, but they're still like locked in.
So if they were listening, what would you say right now if they were listening?
Well, I think ultimately they'd have to do what's right for them, and if they believe in it, that their focus is going to be best given to what the next stage is and how to get more out of yourself, then do that. Don't like to listen to me, everyone's different. But I certainly felt for myself that I probably could have given my... could have done with somebody saying, you've done well, like, this is incredible what you've achieved so far, enjoy it more. I'm not saying forget about getting better, but just enjoy it more, because I can probably count on one hand the number of times I went into a race and felt like, I'm going to win this. I was always the person that was doubting. I think maybe if I had a bit more of a enjoyment capacity of I'm good enough, or you've done this, and there's no reason for you to doubt yourself, or there's less reason for you to kind of feel concerned, I probably would have just done my best in the moment rather than wasting energy on things that I couldn't control. That was a bit of a mash of words there.
No, but, not at all. Not at all.
I think the big takeaway for me now is that when I'm coaching, I think it's a really tough line to tread on, is recognizing the improvements whilst also being forward thinking about where do we want to go next. Have we made the step to where we want to get to? How hard do we want to be in ourselves, and how much do we want to question ourselves and what we've done?
Mm-hmm.
And I think the thing I've learnt from certainly from a coaching perspective is that having a subjective opinion on whether someone should be doing better or worse actually doesn't matter. It's probably better to give people the objective inputs, like you said before, of saying, right, well, This is the outcome we got, and then let's strip it back to what did you do to achieve that, or what did you not do, and then that came to that outcome, and where do you feel like you're prepared to change to alter that end output?
Mm-hmm.
Like, just balancing the equation out so that you can be happier with what it looks like. So if it means that someone's looking at the equation, if you use that, stick with that analogy, someone's done all this stuff, they've kind of trained diligently, but they've gone partying every night, If they're not willing to let go of that social aspect, either they've got to prove something else, or they've got to acknowledge, like, accept that that's always going to be the end result. Is this product? So rather than letting me as a personality come in with my opinion of what someone needs to change, just actually presenting them with information of, like, this is where it's not, why you're not getting the outcome you want to have. It's up to you to make a change on that. I think that's that would have been really useful for me.
Yeah, because you can really address, like, hard issues or maybe things that would be, if you maybe came in pointing a finger at something that could have been better, and why didn't you do this, or why'd you screw up in this? If it's just a bit like, this was good, this is what I saw, this is my interpretation, like, and you go at it kind of impartially, I guess.
Because obviously I've spoken to you before about your career, and I heard it in the various podcasts and stuff you've done, and when you talk so confidently in the fact that you did everything you could when you were in the national team to get the most out of yourself. And as much as I tried my hardest, I definitely tried my hardest to the degree I was comfortable doing. It's not that I was lazy. It was just that I valued my enjoyment higher than going to the absolute minutiae of improvement. That makes
sense. But then that's also the interesting part, is that that's what obviously got you to the level you're at. And if you tried my approach, you probably would have trained poorly. And, like, I really enjoyed the, like, you know, details. Turning every dial, I really love that process.
Yeah.
So
you come back to your question of what would you advise to any kind of internationals
is
I think it's up to you to recognize and look back maybe on what's worked for you before and trust that. Like that's your go to, that's your personality, that's given you the success before. Like, at least do that again with a few kind of twists and cranks and test little bits, because ultimately you're going to have a fingerprint, whether it's your telemetry fingerprint or whether it's your how you train approach, whether it's the attitude you have in the boat, whether it's your your atmosphere, the personality you bring to your crew. Like, don't try and alter that because somebody else did it a different way and has the kind of the medal that you want to get. Mm-hmm. You got to do it your way.
Yeah. It's interesting. I like that. And because maybe like why you're going back to like looking at GB Start and stuff like that, that it's very much the opposite of it, isn't it? It's like, these are the rules. And I think that's where, like, I don't want to get into this too much because you can easily start complaining, but I think that's where, like, bad coaches, in my opinion, are like, this is the format. This is what worked for these people. You know, you come in and you do this format and it will work. And if it doesn't work, then that's your fault. And the blame's on you, not on me, the coach.
Yeah.
And it takes, I think, a lot of, like, I guess coaching is a balance of insecurity and, like, confidence. But, you really need to be confident to take a different approach for different people.
Yeah.
I guess, yeah.
And it's difficult to do because, I've listened to several coaches about how do you balance individualized training within a big program. Like, how do you get that right where the individual can get the most out of themselves, but they are still following the same pattern of where the group's going. I don't know what the correct answer is to that. I don't think anybody does because everyone's trying to figure it out. Like, everyone's just playing around with the idea.
But that's important, I think, to acknowledge that there's no right answer.
I think.
I was saying this to Charlie, actually, and Alex, the strength and conditioning podcast. Like, it's like, that's the worst approach, is if you have your mind made up.
Yeah.
If you don't accept that you'll never know, then you'll get in the way of yourself.
Yeah.
I think. Yeah. So I guess it's true as a coach, but then maybe Yeah, I guess, I don't know, I never felt that very much like, to me, feels like that's what it was like when I was coaching, is having that flexibility and, like, adaptability. But when I was rowing, I guess it was quite different.
I think that there's also, like, there's the, I think the sport, like, generations change, and even, it's definitely a generation between me and the people I'm coaching now, and definitely a big personality difference. For example, when I think back to when I was at university, when there was any kind of bank holidays or whatever that meant we had more free time, or Easter holidays, October holidays, whatever, the time was thrown at rowing and training and going to water more. Now, and this is no criticism to the students, because I think it's not St. Andrews, I think it's just the generation. All the other coaches I speak to in the circuit reflect the same experience I'm having, is that the students have other priorities in their life that are, if not on a par, very close to their rowing aspirations and priorities. So quite often I'll have somebody saying to me, I can't make it to training this week because I'm going to my parents' wedding anniversary, like it's like their 24th wedding anniversary or something like that. Just to me would seem like if I was at university at the time, I'd be like, and this is a generational thing, but having the acknowledgement of their commitment is 100% of what they're willing to commit, just because it's different to what I had, it doesn't mean that it's less. Like it's 100% of what they're wanting to put in. So that's 100%. Just because I would put more in, because that was my priority, was just rowing, doesn't mean I was putting more into it. It's just that. And so, working with the time we've got, and this is why I love working with the athletes at Edge Rowing, is that they all have tons of other life priorities and responsibilities that mean that they can only put a percentage of their 24 hours in a day into their training, but that's still 100%, and that's something that, yeah, come back to yours and my kind of focus of how we approached the peak of our careers, is that my 100% maybe didn't reflect on me having the perfect sleep every night. I wasn't regimented with going to bed at the right time. I would stay up and watch a show that I was addicted to at the time.
There's some things I'm open to saying that, maybe not, but sleep, man.
Oh, yeah, totally. Now, in hindsight, yeah, totally. But I was, at the time, I was just oblivious to it. There's some things, and same with rigging, there's so much stuff when I was in the national team. And again, this is, I don't know how different it is now, but certainly I was probably the more aware of what happens when it comes to rigging than most of the guys in the team, and certainly a lot more than those who came from world-class start, because I just think that they get told, this is your settings, just go out and row, just put your ergo on the water and you'll go fast. Having left the sport, or at least having that year in lockdown, I started to question, what does it matter if I have the spans tighter or further away? And I was curious. I rekindled that curiosity of how can I make the boats go, not necessarily faster, but go different.
What's the phrase? Will it make the boat go faster? It's, you can write, but will it make the boat go different?
Yeah, that's just as nice in terms of how you can say it. Yeah. it rolls off the tongue. I definitely was ignorant to a lot of things that would have made my performance better, and I could unpick loads of stuff, and there'd be loads of people who could do the same thing with probably just observing how I approach my rowing. But I think the thing that everyone who knows of my career will probably say was the fact I was consistent year on year. I just stuck at it. I rarely got ill or injured. Illness was probably the more frequent thing, because I would push myself a bit too far, and I not necessarily pushed too far into illness, but more I would come back from having a cold too early, and then that would prolong my ability to actually benefit from training.
Right.
I suffer massively from FOMO, sort of missing out on something, and so literally 24 hours will pass of me being stuck in bed, and I'll be like on the phone to Scott or Henry and saying, oh, what was training today, tell me the scores, who did this, who did that. And I it was stupid. Like, why would I put more pressure on myself to get back sooner when ultimately my body was trying to tell me to.
Henry and Scott were your two teammates, weren't they?
Henry Fieldman's, he cost me best man at my wedding, best mate, and Scott also a best mate. He's rode with me in the Cox Bear and the Cox is four. Yeah. So yeah, just two of some of the many guys I used to speak to lots. Mm-hmm. I was always, I feel like I'm okay at home and I'm not panting when I'm walking up the stairs anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I should maybe be back at training. I'd feel bad, like I wasn't training. I'd letting someone down by not being there.
Yeah, that's one thing I learned, and I like, you know, I always say when I'm coaching is like, when you get ill or when you get injured or when you have a problem, it's like stop thinking about yourself as a rower. Like, start thinking about yourself as somebody who's fixing that problem, and like your sport. When you're ill, isn't rowing your sport becomes, you know, an illness fixer. Like you're a professional, like illness recoverer.
Yeah, or,
it sounds so lame.
Yeah,
or like, you know, you injure your back. When I hurt my back, that was a big shift for me. It was like I'm just focused. Like I'm not a rower right now. I'm somebody who needs to fix their back. And I think you can also treat it on like a session by session basis as well, where it's like, you know, maybe it's a technical issue. What we notice is that the problem, people are so often trying to row perfectly or perform perfectly, but also make this change at the same time. I think if you try and row perfectly while trying to improve a problem or something you need to work on, you'll never like be able to improve it because you're so worried about keeping the rowing perfect.
Yeah.
And that just gets in the way. Like, I remember when we were on camp with someone, and they were really struggling to square their blades because we got down to the problem was that they were trying to square their blade and have their blades off the water perfect and whatever, take a perfect catch. It was like, think about yourself as a blade squarer. You're not a rower right now. It's like you're a blade squarer. anyway, so yeah, like you're saying, like, yeah, you were when you're ill, you were focused on being a good rower. You're still focused on trying to perform well.
I still struggle to switch off, like when I'm in amongst it, thinking of the crews that I want to try out at St Andrews, or the kind of ideas I have for edge rowing athletes, and how they can improve. Like I struggle to switch off from one to the other to home life. Like I often get clipped around the head from Steph for not switching off and engaging, because that's the balance that I'm trying to learn to do better when I'm at work. And that's probably one of the things that is good about having an office job, is that you when you're at work it's quite easy to work, and when you're at home it's not so easy. But there's that's definitely reflects what my nature, my personality type is. Mm-hmm. I quite get immersed in what I'm thinking about, and to separate is quite tough. But
that's the only way I can realize, like, Pauline and I will have our nice like Sunday routine where we go for a nice walk and get a coffee and stuff. But then normally in the afternoon we just go and chill. Like I find it hard to not start thinking about like work and coaching.
Yeah.
So like one of my things I've learned I like to do is like make modifications to that desk. It sounds so ridiculous, but just like things that aren't actually directly coaching, but then they kind of are related to so the amount of like drills and stuff like that, you'll see. It's a bit embarrassing, I gotta admit, but, I don't know. I don't like. I remember like in lockdown, I was like wondering like, what would my life be like if I wasn't rowing, and a good analogy I always heard for like what you should do when you're with your life is like do what you would do if you had all the time in the day to train. And I was furloughed from my coaching job, and I wasn't rowing because I just had no motivation to. So I had all day to do whatever I wanted. I basically just found myself getting immersed into cycling. So that was kind of a way, actually, through lockdown, I learned things about myself that were like, yeah, I'm actually always going to be somebody that's obsessed into like a sport,
mm-hmm.
be it coaching or doing the sport. So that was a moment of realization for me. But
That was just kind of the same for me in lockdown. I had a similar experience, not because I was like, oh, I really want to get into rowing, because so for some context for the viewers, I just having left Caversham after being told by
we're jumping all over the place, which is entirely my fault. I'm just kind of going with my childish.
You should have some chapters, like some timestamps on this,
a list,
so that people can go.
Well, you know what? That podcast, the Hot Ones with Sean Evans. I hate that show because it's literally, you can just tell so many people like it, but he just reads questions off a list, and I'm like, this is so boring. But anyways, who knows? This is probably quite boring as well. But anyways, sorry, total tangent.
I don't know where I was going.
Lockdown.
Yeah, sorry. So it was when I'd been sent away because Caversham was told, yeah, you're not training at Caversham anymore. We'd just done some pairs testing. It was half of a pairs matrix. And off the back of that, Jürgen was making he made a decision on the Olympic team, and he told everybody there, he listed the whole team that was going to go.
Wasn't it so, like brutal? Wasn't it like
he literally just read the names out, and then nothing, and that was it. Okay, and he said, "Take an hour, go and go home."
Was that so? He read out the team when the Olympics had been cancelled.
When we got told, so the Olympics hadn't been cancelled. Oh, right, it was Caversham. Sure. Everyone was going to go into quarantine. Everyone was going to train at home for a couple of weeks, but. We don't know what the kind of the ground's looking like, so we're going to send you away knowing what the Olympic team is due to be. So I effectively got cut without my name being mentioned, which felt brutal. And I know it's like there was no acknowledgement whatsoever, and I went.
How was
away.
It for Rio? Did they take people into a room one by one?
What, when they told you your selection?
When they told you, like...
Oh, Rio was equally rubbish. Well.
I know you had a point to prove there, so I don't want to... I'm just kind of...
I can jump back again. Rio was funny because we got selected so late. And I think the...
That's right.
It was a letter from David Tanner saying that we'd been selected. But we got told that we would be going to the Olympics if we'd won the last World Cup. So that's the only way we knew, which is, in some ways, it's nice not relying on somebody telling you.
Bullshit.
It's probably as a healthier thing than actually just being told, this: if you win this race, you will go.
Yeah.
But there's still the kind of, because normally you're expecting someone to tell you, we, even though we crossed the line and beat the guys we need to beat, there wasn't that elated... I'm so excited, so happy, like so much to look forward to. It was more as that a relief of we've done it. At least I think we've done it. Hopefully we've done it.
Yeah, you don't know. You can
not sure. And we didn't want to go around asking, are we selected? Are we not?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think I remember saying to my coach at the time, can we get some confirmation? And then he was like, well, you know what the... like how they're doing selection. I was like, yeah, but it'd be nice to hear. It'd be nice to someone's Jürgen or David saying, well done, good job.
Yes.
Like, did the business, and like you're now the pair.
How dare you want to know?
But yeah, jumping back to 2020, we were sent away and I was angry because I just didn't know what to do. I was like, this is way earlier than I'd anticipated this happening. I had no idea what's happening at all because of COVID and what was going to be on the horizon. And Bea had just arrived like 3 weeks prior. my daughter. So
where did you come in trial? Can I ask where you came in the trials? Sorry, I keep doing this. I'm just curious. But like, where did you come in the trials?
So I missed out one person. So the person Tom Jeffrey. Well, it was like they selected the eight and the four, and then they were trying to find the last person for the eight plus the pair that hadn't qualified yet.
Mm-hmm.
So the pair hadn't got hadn't got the right place at the pre-worlds. So yeah, the pair was getting selected, and so I missed out by one place on being the. So I was going to be the spare pair. But it wasn't confirmed because they didn't actually list because they didn't have a confirmation that the pair was going to go. Jürgen, when he announced it, he said the spare pair rather than because it, yeah, you know, okay. That's what he did.
Okay, sorry, yeah.
So I was angry and I went home, and then we ended up moving out to Inverness, my parents' place, because we were having to move house anyway, and rather than moving to somewhere else in the area down south and paying a ton of money and having no space, no support whatsoever, and having to literally live inside a room, we thought maybe it'd be better to take up my dad's offer to stay with them.
Probably the less COVID up there in Inverness.
Yeah, no, that's what we thought, yeah. So did that, and it took me probably a couple of weeks before I even considered jumping in the rowing machine. But I did, after a conversation with Steph and just saying, how are we going to get money? Like, what are we going to do? We need to still have money coming in, and she didn't have a job at the time.
Did they cut your funding?
Well, I would, like, if I stopped rowing, I was like, the initial reason for me getting back in the machine was to continue my funding coming through, because I knew that they wouldn't be able to cut me until they can demonstrate that I wasn't at the standard. And that's so kind of, that was the original reason. And then as time went on, I started to enjoy training on my own and enjoy the stuff that I hadn't ever had a chance to enjoy since when I was a junior, when I was nowhere near skilled enough to know how to be disciplined and follow a program and do all the stuff in the right zones and all that kind of stuff. So, I spent the next few months just training properly because I was on my own. I did it without feeling like someone was over my shoulder looking at me. And
what did training properly look like for you?
Just doing UC2 at the right zone. that was ultimately the biggest thing. Doing UT2 at the right intensity.
Which was?
Well, it was probably still a little bit fast. So it was probably still a little bit fast.
Oh, okay, right.
But I was I would sit around about 138 in a heart rate.
Not split.
No. My split was around about 148.
At a 138 average. Yeah. And then before at Caversham, what were you?
Well, I never had a heart rate monitor.
Okay.
I was one of those guys that just was, again, ignorant to think that. Yeah. Because I was just like, well, Jürgen only cares about the split.
Yeah.
So I just go on and go, well, why would it matter if I have a heart rate monitor or not? Because all it's going to do is make me feel like I should pull harder when I'm already pulling hard enough, or I'm working too hard, but I have to still hit this split. So I just removed that extra data point because I knew it wasn't relevant in that system. Whereas when I was on my own, I was like, well, I'm not going to get crucified for sitting at 150 if I know that that's the right zone, so I'll just sit in that and then see what happens. And I actually did it for a little while and then found my heart rate, my split went down and my heart rate stayed in the same place. Surprise, surprise. And
That's what we always notice, isn't it?
Yeah, you just be patient with it and it'll come down. So yeah, I ended up getting PBs and everything.
What, just day to day, what did you notice the difference in, like, around your training when you properly started to polarize your training? How did you feel different? Was there high intensity feel any different? Or was it like, did you ever feel like you weren't doing enough? Because this is a big thing pretty much most rowers do, is they don't do it easy enough?
Well, I had a lot of stuff changing. So I had a newborn. I had living with my parents, completely different training environment. I was going out to the garage and training in the ergo on my own, and then going into the into town to jump in the canal to single on my own. I was also just transitioning to be to a vegan diet, and I was very, very motivated from a moral perspective, but very much uneducated in knowing how to do it properly. And so I was doing my best at the time. I was trying to read up what I could read up on in the short time I had, but in the day. But yeah, my day to day was very different because I was going out to the machine. I was jumping downstairs after a night of getting up and feeding, and then get some food, jump out in the machine when Steph felt like I could go out without being too much of a hindrance. But she was an angel with taking all of the parenting responsibility away from me, so I could fulfill my job, which was to go out and still be a good rower and be a good athlete.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very lucky and fortunate in that sense, but there was still a significant portion of my day was looking after Bea and feeding where I could, and trying to create opportunities for Steph to have her own time and try to be a family. Like, ultimately, it's all those special moments they're finite. And at the time, everybody in the world was stressed, and I was probably pouring more energy into feeling like I was still attached to something I was familiar with, which was rowing and training. And so that was where my anchor was, and that was where I felt safe, effectively.
Okay. I remember I was shitting myself. I thought, because I heard about, like, people who had COVID, that they would, like, when they did extreme exercise, like, I heard somebody died because they were doing, like, a lot of too much endurance and they had COVID. Yeah. So I was, like, there was, like, 1 or 2 days when I was, like, sat in here, like, oh, my God. I shouldn't joke about it, actually, because, But, yeah, I was stressed.
Yeah. We were, too. Steph's got a multitude of chronic illnesses, and she's so very, very vulnerable. Like, the doctors effectively said, not at the time, but as time went on, she found out that if she got COVID, it would not be a promising outcome. The rowing side of it, training for me, was so different to what it was at GB and anything before that, from a day-to-day perspective. But needless to say, despite the lack of consistent and enough sleep, and definitely not optimal diet, because I wasn't having enough food. I think it was good food, but it wasn't enough of it.
Yeah,
I ended up losing weight. Not a crazy amount, but I was leaner than I ever had been over the next few months. But I the one thing is, so maybe it was a consistency in training in the right zones, maybe it was because I wasn't eating animal parts, but I can't, data point of one isn't good. It's not a good sample size for knowing
that's the thing as well, because we don't really, like, preach it to people, but when I went vegan when I was rowing as well, like, that was one thing people asked, like, oh, did you get better when you went vegan? Well, me going vegan was part of me experimenting and trying to find out a way to get better. So I think when you increase your investment into, like, getting better, you're going to increase your investment in all other areas. Like, if you focus really well on improving your nutrition, that suits you. As a byproduct, you're going to invest more energy into, like, training more consistently and sleeping better and pushing harder on whatever. So you can't just say, like, you know, that's almost like a representation of just overall more commitment to something.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So it's hard to rule it out like you're saying a sample size,
yeah.
But
yeah.
Okay, like so say someone out there has got on you, okay, your situation was very unique, I guess, in COVID. But maybe they have like a newborn or I know someone in our group actually they're like you know, I think it's pretty much today they're expecting. Yeah, anybody, any advice you could give to somebody that's, you know, got a newborn?
I guess the times where I felt like I was in the best of flow was just not caring as much. Just try not to care.
About your kid?
No, about having the routine of like, because if you go for it, you're going to have no routine.
Okay.
You're going to have a kid that's not going to know, care.
Yeah.
And it's going to seek you out as often as they can, and
it doesn't know that you got a 30 rate 20.
Yeah, it doesn't care at all. So why are you wasting energy caring about being on the machine at a certain time?
Okay, so how would your routine change then? Like, what was run through an example of?
Like, I didn't have one. I would work to. I would say to Steph the day before, like, I've got this session. If it was 2-session day. Just so you know, and it wouldn't be a case of okay, well, you can do it this time. It would be a case of like we get up in the morning. I would see how things were, whether Bea was in a good way or whether Steph needed some time to herself or whatever, and I'd stay with them until the point where there was a moment to go. And when I had that time, I just capitalized on it. I just went straight on the machine, switched off from everything else, because if I'm doing anything in between, that's wasting time on both of them. So I think I did, going back to when what we said earlier about me struggling to kind of switch off, that was probably the best point in my life where I felt like I did switch. And like, obviously I'm thinking about the two of them when I'm on the washer at times, but ultimately I enjoyed that moment and that period of time to have to myself. And once I had it, then I could then go back to them feeling like, right, I've kind of satisfied that part of my brain that needs to be focused on something else, and now I can be present in the moment with you guys now. But it's I think caring less is probably a very vague way of, that's not the message I want to give. It's more to that kind of that phrase, but it's the sentiment is
like
just
neurotic.
Yeah, just try to chill and try to, like, you're gonna find ways to do some training, and if you can reward yourself in terms of satisfaction that you've done something, that's way better than nothing.
Yeah.
If you start kicking yourself from one day for literally not having a chance to do it, that's energy being taken away from one, your enjoyment of actually being present with your family, or if it was an illness or something like that, like there's a good reason why you aren't doing that training. But fundamentally, it's still taking away from your enjoyment of the next training session because you're thinking you need to catch up. So kind of having a bit more of a passive approach, and like life kind of comes at you, like use the opportunities when they come to you, when they present themselves, and if they're not there, if you can't do it, then don't get bothered about it. I know that's really easy to say. Like, we sat on a sofa right now, not in shape at all, and definitely have had moments in the last few months where I could do more training, and I do want to. But if your goal is to hit this ergo score, or to be in this team, or to kind of be close to what you were at college level whilst being a dad or a mum, then like having that kind of awareness and of what you're doing outside of the training that can maybe contribute towards a more positive outcome, what you're prepared to sacrifice. Because you are going to sacrifice something, whether it's time to scroll on your phone. Because, I mean, I'm a victim of that so often. You just find yourself going down a rabbit hole of something that seems quite interesting to you, and then before you know it, you've wasted half an hour, and it could have been half an hour lifting some weights or just doing some bodyweight stuff. And it took me a long time to stop punishing myself for having those moments, because everyone's human. It's like, yeah. I know you're less human than me because you managed to do everything you're in your
I didn't there. Actually. I mean, I maybe say that a bit too much. But maybe there's a few weeks.
I'm kidding.
Yeah.
I think being a bit more easy in yourself is a massive point in people's lives. And if you can hold on to fitness, that's a success. If you're holding fitness whilst having a child, maybe not getting better, but that's huge. You've got a whole other human you're bringing into the world, and you're bringing up and looking after, you're responsible for.
Yeah.
If you're holding any kind of fitness, that's a big, big achievement. That would be my message.
Okay. I mean, obviously I can't speak on at the moment, because we don't have any kids, but
you go to Tokyo.
Yeah, I go to Tokyo. Okay. So I rewind now. We kind of covered some of this stuff. That was a big thing I wanted to talk about, was just like hitting a PB at 34. Actually, maybe that's something. So you got into the team. What age were you when you got into the team?
26.
26. So again, most people kind of get in around 22-ish. And then you improved from 26 to 34. So I know a lot of people listening will, you know, be 40 plus, 50, 60, 70, whatever. And 34 versus, say, your peak physiology at 30 isn't much of a difference. But was there anything you had to do differently being an older athlete, like in the team where there's lots of like 24, 26-year-olds, 28-year-olds?
If I was doing anything different, I wasn't conscious of them. The only thing I was conscious of was that I knew I had to perform at a level that was unquestionable that they'd have to select me. So like, there was always the assumption that if someone was, for me in a way, if someone got the same result or performance as me, but they were doing it 3 years younger than me, they're gonna get selected because they've got more potential
in their rowing career. Yeah, I noticed that as well, actually,
So I would always think, well, if this person is younger than me, and most of them were, if I want to get selected, I have to absolutely smash them in training and racing. So if there was someone that's the same speed as me and they're younger than me, I couldn't in reality expect to be given the nod by Jürgen. So and that's kind of the what I experienced in that first Olympiad. Like I had a lot of success, but I did feel like there was opportunities that were given to others that I didn't experience. And so, for example, I never rode with any of the, like, I never was in a pair with any of the kind of London medalists at all. So the guys from the four, guys from the eight, or the guys from the pair, I never rode with any of them. Whereas a lot of the guys who came through in the group I was in, they rode at times with in pairs with Alex Gregory or Hodgie or Pete Reed or whatever. So I never got that, I guess, sharing of huge experience that they would have had.
Yeah, okay. And so that kind of, less so, like, you didn't notice anything then as you aged. It was more just...
Sorry, I went on a tangent there. Yeah, sorry. No, I didn't.
But no, that's right. It's still relevant.
I didn't do anything different. I think it was more, I felt like I had, certainly when I first joined the team, I felt like maybe I wouldn't have as long a career as anybody else. I assumed that, well, if these people are just getting in and at the same time as me and they're 3 more years than me, the assumption is going to be that they're going to have 3 more years later on than I will have, so I'm going to stop before them. So I felt like it was a bit more of a times pressure on me. But ultimately, getting into the team was more than I ever anticipated doing. I didn't even think I was going to get to row for GB for a long period of my career, well, most of my career. And then when I'm training with these guys, I'm thinking, this is a bonus. Like, if I can just hang on for a bit, I could, who cares? Like, if I get tapped out at 27, and like, it was back to that Leander mentality, yeah, I'm going to get cut. So I just enjoyed every day. I remember going out in a set of different pairs and just thinking to myself, right, this is going to be the day that they're going to say, right, we've had enough of you, you can head back. Because I joined off the back of Tom Clark being injured and right. one other guy being injured. So I did some...
Shout out last trip.
I was talking about Tom Clark and how was... I only got the team as a result of him being injured.
Right.
And it was off the back of that I got invited to fill in for a seat in a pairs matrix, well, not a pairs matrix, so it was actually just training. And then I found myself in a group that was just going different crews, different pairs, sorry. And my training approach was the same as it was at Leander, and I just thought, I'll make every single session as good as it can be on the water, so that I can feel like if this happens to be the last session, I'll be content. Before I go away. So,
but maybe there's something in that then. It's like, because you're not thinking long term or worried about long term results, that you are, it's forcing yourself to be maybe more in the moment. Maybe part of that is you pushing yourself harder than is sustainable, but also just having that urgency. And that's one thing that I always like to talk about, is when you're making a change or an improvement, you need to have that like sense of urgency that I think far too often people can be complacent if it's day one of winter training, or you know, they're still 3 months away from Henley, that I can figure out how to get the stroke right. It's like, no, you need to like change it now. And if you don't, like, you're just, if you have that mindset where it's just a bit too like, oh, it's fine, okay, it's a bit more comfortable to just do what I've always done, you're not going to make any improvements. So that's maybe, I'm just thinking about like, what is it about your thought process that's giving you the environment, the space to have good improvement?
Yeah, I think there was, that was an acute period. Like you said, it's maybe not sustainable for a career. It's not definitely that mindset you'd want to have for a whole season, because you'll burn out. Like, there's no way of doing that. But for condensed period of I'm going to fast track myself to a new level, and I was fortunate not to get ill, which is it's good, and that obviously makes a big difference. So I had like managed to string some good training together, as well as good sessions on the water. So those things are naturally going to step you up a level, but over a whole season, you can't like reliably get that to happen. Like, have a whole season without illness or injury, and be able to focus that hard. It's just not, it's not reasonable to put that on anybody or put on yourself. Mm. But I do agree, like, there's times in the season where you do need to make changes, and it's important to not think, oh, I'll do it next month, or I need to work in my hamstrings, but today's not the day to really think about hamstrings. So I'm just going to kind of do it through quarter slides and or not rock over as much as I should be able to. Like, there's no better time to make a change if you know you have a change to make than now, because it's the most time you'll ever have to make that change. Whereas the more time that passes, like, the less opportunity. So the key thing for me was, once I got into the team, was it wasn't that I kept that mentality. It was more just, that seemed to work for me.
Yeah,
I'll try and keep that in the back of my mind. I'll try and recognize that there's value to making the most out of a given session, because that will have a knock-on effect. Because there's like, there's multitude of different reasons, but one of them being that people wanted to row with me. I think by and large, I was enjoyable to row with in a pair, because
you're just a legend.
No, obviously, but until I talk about that too much on the air. But I think I just made it comfy for people to row. I made it, no one got stressed rowing with me. It's probably why I ended up rowing Noddy, because I put up with his shit. shout out Noddy.
I'm not even in the fucking picture right now.
You were a bit.
Was I? Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah, you were. I think you were. Yeah. It's a bit of a fisheye lens. Mm. Yeah, I think it was just the kind of the focus on getting the session to go well meant that the people who were rowing with me in the future would look forward to rowing me, and therefore their mentality was better, and then we'd have a better session, so the training was better. Yeah. So it'd have an always knock-on effect, and just so even though the one small kind of input was me being focused on not getting cut and getting the most out of that session by trying my hardest, being super focused, that's not maintainable. There is an underlying kind of, there's lots of positives that come from that. So like I said, crewmates run with you, coaches being observing me, the crews I go out in and thinking, oh, they seem to always have a good session with the row with Alan.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden things kind of sort themselves out, and then I guess you leave that stuff that's out of your control to happen on its own, but I've got control over whether I can put myself 100% into the session.
That
opens up opportunities, and
such good advice.
That's something I think we I'm echoing from earlier in the conversation about just like going into rowing, like it was, I enjoyed it. I had a control over what I was doing. I was putting this work, effort, and time into it, and it was giving me more opportunities to grow as an individual, and as an athlete, and finding out more things about the world, and traveling incredible places, and racing incredible people.
Yeah, look where it took you.
I'm very lucky to have.
Well, lucky, yeah. An element of luck for sure, but very much down to like your approach. I think that's just. Yeah, again, something I hadn't really considered is like how your approach facilitates this growth from someone who was a 6'42k at age 19, which I think is so valuable. And I think what was jumping out as well as you're saying that was not just your ability to do that for one session, but to do that for every session and to have those bullshit blinders on of just like to do it consistently. I think everybody could probably go out after this podcast and listen to, you know, just really enjoy one session, be really focused on themselves. But when it gets hard is when it's like, you've been doing it for a few months, you get a bit bored, or you get a bit tired, or you have a bad result, then that's when you let the other stuff creep in. But it sounds like you certainly did an amazing job of just doing it every single session and being that reliable person that everybody wanted to row with. So you're starting to blush a little bit over there. Yeah. But yeah.
Well, you're just jealous you never got to row with me. So
yeah, I know.
That's the main reason.
I know. Well, we might be going out on a double quite soon. So I'll let you know if all this, how much of it's true.
Need to find a big enough boat.
Yeah. Definitely not rowing it. Definitely retired.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think that's quite a really good spot to end the podcast. I hope, if you're listening, then there's stuff that you can definitely take away. Go away and I think definitely try and find your own way, kind of tying in with what we're talking about, find your own way of implementing what Alan's talking about into your training. And you'll find speed and more improvement and more enjoyment for sure. Alan, thank you very much.
Thanks for having me.
I am always very bad at ending these. Should we end with an awkward handshake?
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Is this your go-to?
it's a first.
Absolute weirdo.
Yeah. But yeah, okay, right. Bye. Oh yeah, like and subscribe.
Yeah, that.